All right, thank you very much, Chris and Toshiba, for inviting me to speak today. My name is Bob Peters, and I'm a private practice radiologist in Manhattan. Almost exactly a year ago, we installed an Aquilion Prime 160 in our office. And to say the least, the Prime 160 has exceeded our expectations since its installation. This equipment excels in CT imaging in general. We have a body practice as well as a cardiac practice. And so it's very important that we do the body imaging as well, but also most significantly for us and for you is that it excels in cardiac CT imaging as well. So I want to take the opportunity to describe some of the unique features of the Prime 160 and Toshiba's unique ability to do cardiac imaging in a very efficient and simple manner. So I want to try and structure this talk as a series of challenges, because cardiac CT is a very challenging study. So let's take this first case, this first challenge, as we have a 18-year-old female, and she's going off to college. And over the past few months, she's developed a somewhat debilitating shortness of breath and palpitations. These symptoms seem to be connected with exertion. And her workup has included echocardiography as well as an echo stress test. And so with the abnormal stress test, basically during recovery, she dropped her blood pressure, but her wall motion looked normal. So obviously our big challenge is to exclude a coronary anomaly. So the patient arrives, you know, she's 18 years old, this is a new experience. She's apprehensive, her parents are apprehensive, they're accompanying her, of course, and her admission vitals include a heart rate of 107, blood pressure of 99 over 72. So we're kind of having a little trouble here because we don't have a lot of room with her blood pressure to give her the typical things to lower the heart rate. In my office, we try IV hydration in many patients, and you can see that effect was useful as her heart rate then, after 500 cc's of IV hydration, she was a normal sinus rhythm, a little variable, 65 to 75 beats per minute, but again, her blood pressure remained somewhat low. So our major concern is radiation dose. We don't want to over-radiate this young woman, and again, with a heart rate that is in the 70s, we have to think about what kind of protocol we're going to use. Well, the prospectively triggered ECG imaging, which is the low-dose option, is probably out of the question due to the elevated and variable heart rate. So we're now left with the retrospective gated imaging in a modulated mode, or the continuous mode, retrospective gated imaging in the continuous mode. But we have this secret weapon, and it's called Toshiba's Shore Exposure with Ader 3D. So I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to say we're going to go ahead and do a continuous mode. We're going to keep the tube current on the whole time and see what we get. So here are the images, which is a retrospective study. You can see that the coronary anatomy is normal. You can see that there's normal connection of the left main. There's no atherosclerosis, and there's normal function and morphology. So really now we have an 18-year-old female. We've had the tube current on the whole time, and we have to ask ourselves, well, what do you think the radiation dose is? So in your mind, kind of guess which of the three options we have here. Well, the radiation dose for this scan was 1.2 millisieverts, and that's quite spectacular. Incidentally, the contrast dose was 51 cc's. So just how big of a deal is this? Well, on our prior equipment, we actually published a study in 2009 looking at prospective gating and retrospective gating. And using this prior equipment, you'll see that the retrospective gating studies we're averaging about 15.1 millisieverts. This is pretty typical of what cardiac CT was like before we had prospective gating. And we were one of the first labs to describe the prospective gating technique, and we were getting at that point 3.4 millisieverts. So you can see that with a 1.2 millisievert retrospective study, we have significantly decreased radiation dose to patients using the shore exposure and ADER 3D. But now I think you're wondering, well, all right, so he's giving us the little girl down the block. What about a normal size patient? So here's another case of a 195-pound male, again, using shore exposure and ADER 3D. And what do we have here? We have a total dose of 4.2 millisieverts. You can see a nice plaque here, a nice mixed plaque in the RCA, as well as some calcified plaques in the LAD, and again, normal structure and function. So in all honesty, when these numbers are coming off of our dose reports, which are so low, it begged the question of what is the real difference between our prospective and retrospective patients. So we actually took the last 100 patients and averaged the doses for the prospective cases versus the retrospective cases. And you can see here that for prospective cases, the average dose was 3.5 millisieverts, which was very similar to what we were seeing in 2009. But what you'll see on the retrospective cases using shore exposure and ADER 3D from Toshiba, you get an average retrospective study of 4.3 millisieverts. This is such a significant result that actually in small patients, patients less than 140 pounds, I've told the technologists to run everybody retrospectively. We do not do prospective gated studies on people with on patients less than 140 because we can get all the data and the radiation dose remains extremely low. Just to, again, compare, this is what our study was in 2009. You can see the difference, almost a 75% improvement in radiation dose for retrospective imaging. So how is this accomplished? This is probably a very big question to everybody. Shore exposure and ADER 3D utilize the z-axis to determine the amount of dose. So you'll see on the top two slides, you have the AP and lateral views with the dose, with the MA dose on the bottom line, and the z-axis changes in MA on the dose is on the Y. And with prospective gating, you can see that it sets a MA level at the maximum. So where you have the maximum amount of tissue, it's gonna set as its maximum MA, and it doesn't vary that MA through the process. On modulated mode, you can see here that through the cardiac cycle, it increases and it decreases the MAs depending on the z-axis. But again, what it does is it sets a level at the highest attenuation point in the scan. Alternatively, using shore exposure, you can see that the MAs are modulating throughout the whole cycle. So you see up by the shoulders, you have the highest radiation dose being delivered by MA, and then as you get through the shoulders and into the mediastinum and heart, the MAs drop. So that's how you're developing this cost savings. What then happens is your prospective study is 203 DLP, your modulated study is 350 DLP, and your continuous mode is 320 DLP. So you're saving more in the continuous mode, and you're keeping it very low at the same time. So the bottom line is that one of the major challenges for cardiac CT is radiation dose. And with these new techniques, we're able to really reduce the dose and provide the best care for the patients, especially young patients or people with variable heart rates. So let's go on to our next challenge. So our next challenge is the 6 p.m. on Friday call. So a referring physician colleague calls you to add on a chest pain patient, and your usual cardiac CT technologist goes home ill. So what happens is that you have your per diem patient, you know, Joe shows up, and you have to scan a patient with a very complicated study. So what exactly does a CT technologist have to do when performing a cardiac CT? Well, there's a lot of different things. They have to assess the heart rate variability, the cardiac rhythm. They have to decide about a scan mode, a reconstruction mode, the KV, the MA. They have to do a test bolus. On our prior scanner, these are all things that had to be done by the technologist, and they had to be knowledgeable about each one of them. With the Aquilion Prime 160, this is all folded into the protocol. It's very efficient, and the technologist is able to get through it with just one or two clicks. What's the result? So third day on the job, X-ray technologist we hired didn't have any CT experience. The phone call came at 6 p.m., everybody was gone, and she's stuck there. Third day on the job, this is the study that came out, a beautiful study with an effective dose of 1.9 millisieverts. So this is a very busy slide, but the point of the slide here is to explain that if you don't have all of these variables set and under control by the scanner, a technologist will have to input whatever they think is correct. I read for two centers other than my own, in New York and in Maryland. So they send me the cases, and these are the last 15 cases that I've seen from them. You'll notice that this guy, 52-year-old male, 190 pounds, got 31 millisieverts of dose. If I add up all these things, the average they're giving in these other sites are 19 millisieverts. And why is that? Why are they over-radiating people? It's because the scanners are not made to help the technologists make the right choices. And so they're just putting in all the top factors to try and make the images as good as possible. This is something that would not happen on a Toshiba scanner. So what did this 18 millisievert exam look like? So here it is. You can see it's in modulated mode, so part of the images are blurry, and the coronaries look pretty good. And here's our study, 195 pounds, 4.2 millisieverts on the Aquilion Prime. Very good image quality. So, what's our next challenge? We've talked about radiation dose and how hard it is to do CT scanning. What about the patient that has an irregular heartbeat? So this is the person in AFib, somebody who has frequent APCs or PVCs. 1 year ago, I would cancel these cases, and I would call the referring physician and say, really? AFib? Really? At this point now, I actually encourage people to send people in AFib or people with ectopy. With the Toshiba system, the real-time beat control, you can reassure your referring physicians and technologists that an irregular rhythm is not a contraindication to a cardiac CT. So here's a typical scenario. You have a normal sinus rhythm until, well, it's not normal sinus. And what you see here is a prospective scan, you have an APC, and then with the real-time beat control, the prime switches into continuous mode and creates these beautiful pictures with no evidence for ectopy. Even in the case of something where you have irregular beats, such as atrial fibrillation, the real-time beat control does an amazing job of eliminating the artifact, the motion artifact, and you get spectacular images such as this case. So what's our next challenge? Our next challenge is scanning multiple vascular territories, right? So a lot of people are interested in TAVR these days. Well, you have to scan multiple areas. I get a call from a referring doctor. This guy wants a cardiac exam. Apparently there's an abnormal chest x-ray and they want to see if there's a mediastinal mass. The patient's renal function is not great, so they're interested in the renal arteries, and they want a pelvic runoff, all for low dose and in somebody with borderline renal function. Toshiba has a protocol, a variable helical pitch. So let me go ahead and just show you how this works. At the beginning, in the chest, in the heart, you get a retrospectively gated cardiac protocol. As soon as it's through the heart, it's switched to a high-pitch CTA protocol to scan the rest of the body. And what's the net effect? You get a data set that includes the heart, as you can see here, there's the mediastinal mass. And then we have the renal arteries and the CTA of the abdomen and the pelvis. And what did this cost? 4.8 millisieverts. Typically, you couldn't do an abdomen pelvis CTA for 4.8 millisieverts. We're getting a chest and a cardiac as well. Here's another case. Of a patient with an abdominal aortic aneurysm, but also a question of coronary artery disease. So using variable helical pitch, we obtain excellent imaging of the coronary arteries. You can see the non-obstructive calcified plaques in all three vessels. Again, we get a nice view of the valves, structure, and function. And then you get a complete runoff, chest, abdomen, and the pelvis. You can see that we have the chest, abdomen, and pelvis. We have the renal artery, and then a nice MIP view here of the aneurysm in relationship to the left renal artery. Again, what is this? This is a 180-pound female. The total amount of contrast is 77 cc's. So I just want to kind of quickly go over some of the challenges in cardiac CT and how they are addressed with Toshiba's unique techniques. We want to try and eliminate or decrease radiation dose. We want to try and make things simpler to make it easy for typical techs to perform the test. We need to take care of arrhythmias and deal with multiple vascular territories. This is all done exceedingly well with the Prime 160. I also like to point out that this is a radiology machine. You can do biopsies on it. You can do body work. You could do brains. If you're looking for a machine, and you have to buy one machine in the hospital, and you want to, and your cardiologists, and you want to make your radiologist colleagues happy, this is a machine that can do both exceedingly well. Thank you very much.